Welcome. I'm Caroline Cronson, producer of Works and Process, the performing arts program at the Guggenheim. We're thrilled to host Insights with acclaimed choreographer Alejandro Cerrudo, New York City Ballet principal dancer Adrian Danchig-Waring, and New York City Ballet principal dancer Joseph Gordon, with a discussion moderated by Peter Boal, artistic director of Pacific Northwest Ballet. This is our first viewing of two WPA Virtual Commissions. We created WPA Virtual Commissions as a direct response to the current pandemic to support artists financially and creatively during these challenging times. So tonight we'll start by showing With You by Alejandro Cerrudo and Ana Lopez. Peter will join them for a brief discussion, and then we'll play I've Been Waiting for This by Joseph Gordon and Adrian Danchig-Waring. They will then join Peter and the discussion will continue. We'll wrap up with an emotional goodbye around 7:30. You'll be able to view these and our other commissions on our media channels accessed through www.worksandprocess.org. And now, thank you and enjoy.
Thank you so much for that. It was beautiful to see again.
Thank you, Peter. It's so good to see you.
I cannot believe that you can make a tissue musical, but you did it again. So well done. Yes. You are, I should tell people, they may know this, but you are Pacific Northwest Ballet's first resident choreographer. In mid-March, you were in Seattle. We were staging a rather massive work. From those circumstances in Seattle, what has your isolation been like? Where have you been isolating, and what's the impact?
Well, right from Seattle, Anna and my daughter, we came straight home to Chicago, and we've been here since. And really, we've been in quarantine, like most people, since then. We barely go to the supermarket, and now lately we started to go outside a little bit more than before. But of course, we haven't seen friends. Of course, we haven't seen family. So it's been hard, like everyone else. Yeah.
So you live in large spaces. You move. You make dancers move. What is your space like? What is your square footage like for this quarantine?
Well, it's a one-bedroom apartment, and it's a small one-bedroom. I mean, we love it here. We need to move out anyway because we became a family now. So, and creating this work, it was inspiring at the time. I say at the time because it, you know, I went, well, first of all, I wanted to say thank you to Work and Process for creating this platform for artists, because it's incredibly special and much needed for us. So when Duke called me, I was very excited because I had this idea, and I was so thankful of, I am so thankful for this. So I tried that idea with Anna, and it really did not work. We really failed miserably at it. So we still had to create something, and then is when it hit us how small our space was, and how we're used to creating in large spaces, and how big of an impact it was, not only to make something in our apartment, but to make something with tools that we're not used to. Every tool that we use was foreign to us, including video. And video is such important part of the medium right now, right? And I'm a choreographer, I'm not a video artist. And there is a lot of editing in that video. So it was a lot of challenges, and we tried many ideas, and many did, most of them didn't work. Got very frustrating, as well as inspiring. So that was the situation. It's not, I think every artist feels different about this, but it's, at least for me, it wasn't so easy to make. Yeah.
There are sort of two levels of isolation that we feel. One is we've been very confined to where we live and the people that we live with, but even masks themselves have an isolating feeling. Did you see tissues as an analogy for those masks?
I mean, I didn't see it the very first time I saw the effect. We just figured it out by playing. Once we didn't know what to do, once our great idea did not work, we were thinking, what are we gonna do now? So we just started playing around. We played in the bathroom with lighting, because also for this video, we knew we didn't want to include our daughter in it. So the only time we could work on it, it was during her nap time, and she's a terrible napper. So we had a very limited time to do it, and we tried things in the bathroom. We tried different, like, very random stuff to see if something would spark. And finally, one day I just took a tissue, you know, and then I thought, well, I think we could perhaps do something with this, you know. And that's how we started playing with it. And then when I saw a link with the music, I saw the symbolism in it. But I also, for us, was very important to try to create a video that wasn't so much beating on COVID, and you know, we wanted to make something light as well. So we had that very present. So we didn't want the tissue just to be so clearly about that, you know, I mean, of course the symbol is there, but we hope that the lightness of it, you know, is bigger than that symbol.
Having steeped myself in a great deal of your creation and choreography, you have a way of infusing both humanity, levity. There's always humor present in your work, and there is in this. And it still has such a deep poignancy. But I thought, in a microcosm of what your body of work looks like, you captured it beautifully here. I wanted to ask you, because, you know, we live in a different world now. It seems like the world around us is absolutely crying out for solace, for perspective, for interpretation. And there's also a tremendous call for change. How do you see in this national climate, how do you see artists responding, representing, being in step with where the world is today?
It's very, very inspiring to see artists speaking out and continue to create and see organizations like Work and Process creating platforms for artists. So it gives hope. But we're all waiting for when is the next thing. We're over having to be okay with this. You know, we need change, and we need these things to move forward and to improve. So I am with every other artist, and as sort of mentioned before, for me this is an awfully uninspiring time, and I see a lot of amazing stuff on the internet right now. So I just wanted to say that, because I felt guilty at first that I wasn't that inspired or creating the whole, you know, this whole time. And I'm thinking I should be making things no matter what. I should be making things, but you know, everybody's different, and I just wanted to say, you know, for any artist that is watching right now, that it is okay if you don't feel inspired, and you know, things will pass, and maybe the way we feel also will change. So we don't have to force that, you know, just because there is so much coming at us, that doesn't mean that inspire you to create something. Maybe it doesn't inspire you, like it doesn't inspire me to create. So that's my message. That's my message.
That's beautiful, Alejandro. And I tell you, as I watched it alone the first time, and there were moments that I sighed, and there were moments that I laughed, and then I watched it with my wife, Kelly. And the shared experience is something I miss the most. And I think we're having that now, but I can't wait until we're back to entire audience.
Yes, me too. Absolutely.
And I just want to say the co-presenters for this commission for Alejandro's and Anna's work are the Center for the Arts at George Mason University, Hubbard Street Dance Chicago, the Joyce Theater, and also Kaatsbaan Cultural Park and Pacific Northwest Ballet. Alejandro, I know you're off to Europe tomorrow. You're going to be creating there. You're headed for Prague, and I know you have a stop at your home in Spain, or your parents' home as well. Yes. So thank you for this work. Thank you for joining us. And we'll
My take pleasure. Over. And thank you, Peter, for doing this. Much love to you and to PMB.
Okay. All right.
Thank you, everyone.
Bravo, a pleasure to see.
Hi.
Wonderful. I've been waiting for this. The sponsors for that, the co-sponsors, I should say, are Allies in Art, Dyamant Pictures, and the Jerome Robbins Dance Division of the New York Public Library. I've now seen that work three or four times, and what struck me this time is there's such a divide in the middle from interior to exterior, and also throughout. I feel like your energy reaches beyond the lens of the camera constantly. Either you're helping each other to get there, or it's just something that dancers do. The title, tell us the title. I've been waiting for this. What's behind that? What is this?
Sure. Well, it's a line that's repeated several times in the song itself. And when we had the second half of the music composed, it's actually repeated several times. And I think it speaks to, we're waiting for a different time. We're waiting to find each other. We're waiting to find something beyond ourselves. And it just felt like an organic title.
Yeah. Yeah. And then there's a second layer. I think it's worth mentioning that we took our sweet time with this video commission. I think we spent about 4 months sort of working up to develop this content. Neither of us have experience choreographing, directing, art directing. And so it was a really immersive process for us to learn new improvisational modalities, to play with our iPhone, to figure out how to chase light. Mm-hmm. And I've been waiting for this in some way also serves to illuminate the silver linings of this fallow period. I think that we all kind of felt like we got a Zen slap mm-hmm. when the coronavirus hit, and that we were being required to sit and contemplate these bigger questions that we often don't carve out the space and time to address.
Yeah. And you know, you just mentioned something, Adrian, that Alejandro was talking about, I should be creating, like that urge that I should be doing something, but I think you can't. I mean, I think at some point you need to process, and creation comes when it comes. It can't come on demand. It can't come, you know, at noon for that day. It's got to have that reflection, and then it comes back to us. Tell us about the setting, because we have, I don't know, what was your quarantine like? Did it begin in a small New York City apartment? It obviously moved outdoors to nature. What were the physical circumstances of it?
Well, we have been immensely fortunate during this period. Joe was actually in Berlin when borders started closing and lockdowns were being implemented. I was still in New York. I had just finished a working session at the New York Choreographic Institute, which is an affiliate of New York City Ballet that I now direct. Lincoln Center shut down all constituent organizations at 5 p.m. on March 12th, which now feels like a lifetime ago. And on the 13th, I took a train out to Shelter Island to visit friends for what I believed would be a three-day weekend. And we've been here ever since, owing to the generosity of those friends. Joe returned from Europe, and we undertook a very serious quarantine in this house, our friend's home, and have just continued to settle into it and benefit from this access to nature.
Yeah, that's been like one of the luckiest parts of this whole time, is being able to have the Meshomic Preserve, where we shot the second half of the portion of the film, and the Sylvester Manor, both on the island, and they're very accessible and have beautiful walking trails. And that was really became very important for us to do every day. As a way to get out of the house when we could and kind of get out of our thoughts and just reflect in a more peaceful setting.
I think we've talked about bubbles and pods, and I think we all get drawn into much, much smaller circles, if you will. And sometimes the circle is a circle of one. And I was curious, to what degree is there a circle of two between the two of you in a way, a line segment, I guess? And if you could expand those circles out, you're staying with friends, and you have this other large extended family, which is the New York City Ballet. What are communications like between fellow dancers, and how has this time affected the two of you?
It's a series of loaded questions. Yeah. thank you for that.
I'll start with you two.
Well, I think that this has been an immense period of deepening our relationship. both personally and creatively. I think it's important to acknowledge that for the most part, in our roles as principal dancers at New York City Ballet, we're not generative artists. We certainly participate in the collaborative process with choreographers and designers, but the root and seed of creative ventures has very rarely begun with us. And so there was that to navigate jointly, to truly collaborate from the ground up. Where community is concerned, our friends here really became our family. We as soon as it was warm enough to do so, we started having these Sunday night sacred suppers, you know, outside in our parkas at a safe distance.
We would also meet them for walks, socially distanced walks, earlier in the pandemic when it felt safe to do so. So they were really a lifeline for us here. Yeah.
And this commission from Works in Process was also a lifeline in a really profound way, because it allowed us to engage in a meaningful long format conversation with all the collaborators who contributed to this work, but also with other members of our community whose aesthetics we respect, whose musical sensibilities helped guide us. We would send, you know, dailies, you know, text message, iPhone video to friends for feedback as we started to develop the language of this video.
This video is going to sell more iPhones, I tell you that. How about the New York City Ballet family, that you've been sort of instantly deprived of having that interaction? Is there communication that goes on, projects that you talk about for the future?
Absolutely. I think it's it feels a bit fractured at this moment. It's such an emotional time. And I think that the uncertainties that lie ahead lead us all at various points into this sort of like fear-based sort of behavioral patterns. And I sincerely hope that moving forward, this community of dancers and the broader company really recommits our energies to collective growth and introspection. I think it feels so vital that right now we're also really reconciling with the histories of institutional racism in our country, in our arts organizations, in the ways that resources are allocated, in the kind of transparency and lack of transparency that major institutions have practiced. I can't help but believe that everything is interconnected, and spending so much time in nature, walking, forest bathing, has really driven that point home. It's now undeniable.
I think many of us found, I found living near a park, like I had to get out every day. I had to walk. I mean, I didn't do a double sotobas like Joe did. But talk to me, Joe, you brought this up first about nature as solace. Is that a new thing for you as a human and as an artist? And how did that serve you?
I wouldn't say it's new for me. I definitely always feel a cleansing and a reset after spending time in nature. But I think, especially in this time, it really became the place where I felt okay processing everything that was going on, both in terms of the institution we work for and in this country. I don't know if I can even articulate it, but it just felt, every time I left, I felt different than when I went in, which wasn't to say that everything was fixed or I felt all of a sudden optimistic. I just felt like I had more space and more equanimity to think about these new realities and this new paradigm that we were all living in.
And I think that sense of passage, like the movement through some kind of threshold from one paradigm into another, I think was very much the basso profundo of this work. And that's why it has this diptych structure.
In this video, it strikes me as a source of liberation. And there was beautiful, poignant, connected moments in interiors, but it just became like suddenly there was this beautiful expansion that happened out in nature. Adrian, you mentioned this before. You don't call yourself choreographers. You might after this video, you might need to. You're not lighting designers, you're not costume designers, you don't do scenic play. How is it to take on all of those roles to put into one project? Because this was just the two of you, wasn't it?
It was a lot of learning curves. I think, well, we it was kind of like a growing conversation. We're just, again, so grateful that they let us extend and extend and extend our deadline, because it had many iterations. You know, at first, one concept we had was to show the quotidian repetition kind of banalities of quarantine life. And so we shot.
And we realized that's terrible art film.
It was not interesting to look at us reading a book or, you know, vacuuming or something in our apartment. And we realized that we needed to start to choreograph. We needed to start to get up, push ourselves out of our comfort zone a little bit. So I don't know what else you.
I think we largely approached it. We increasingly approached it as like an improvisational exercise. So we were tasking ourselves with responding to the physical environment against a window with the blinds shut, for example, or, you know, on a golden mountaintop, and really trying to let our bodies respond to that space without it feeling like a choreographic pursuit. And I'd say a large percentage of the dancing, my dancing specifically, came from those improv exercises.
And I also, something you said earlier about how, you know, you can't wait for inspiration. You have to kind of, inspiration doesn't come when you want it to, that you have to, that it's kind of capricious in that way. And all of a sudden we would have these moments where, you know, we would be out for the daily constitutional in the forest. And I all of a sudden was like, our film needs to culminate here. This is where the path leads, or this is where the portal leads to. Or Adrian one day found this black sheet in the closet and was like, we need to make this negative space. And so it would just, all of a sudden the project would totally shift and the conversation would change. And it was a very
fluid
process.
I don't know if you're following the chat room, but somebody said they would like to see you two vacuuming. That would be a just fine film for them. So maybe that's the next one. Listen, you've talked about solace in nature, but I tell you, in this day and age, when there's so much going on in our world, we find solace in the work of artists like you two and like Alejandro. So I want to thank you for that. And also, as you've all mentioned, for Works in Process, for commissioning these incredible works. It's a treat, and it offers the perspective that we all need. So thank you for talking with us, and thank you all for joining us.
Thank you, Peter.
You're welcome. Take care.